Good evening. It's nice to see so many students here tonight. I used to be a student. Probably unlike a lot of you, I had a pretty tough first quarter as a student. Not so much because of the coursework, that was okay, but because I discovered television. And that was something I didn't have a chance to see too much growing up. And in particular, I was captivated by Star Trek, reruns of Star Trek. I'm not that old, reruns of Star Trek. And in particular, these interstellar voyages led by a courageous and emotional captain, a cerebral and a somewhat logical first officer, a science officer, and I thought, finally, a role model. But what was remarkable about Star Trek, particularly to those of us working in this field that Matt mentioned, is that it was a remarkable predictor of new technologies. You know, in Star Trek, even in the late 60s, people had universal translators. They had mechanical devices they could talk to and exchange languages with both aliens and foreign visitors. And today we have these applications on our smartphones. It's quite remarkable. They had personal access devices where they could take data from all manner of sources and have it readily available on the desktop. And today we have that in the form of tablet computers, where all of you can access information from the World Wide Web trivially for a few $100s. It really was remarkable that people thought about this. And more recent episodes of Star Trek brought up the idea of holograms, where you could have virtual realities, right? You could bring characters from the past and visit them, particularly important characters. And today, well, we have Michael Jackson. And we also have virtual realities, of course, that are an expanding presence in our lives. But one of the most appealing technologies, and what I want to talk about this evening briefly, is the transporter. Arguably the most exciting technology, where we will be dissolved into our constituent atoms, sent over vast distances, and then reconstructed, hopefully together. Well, that's a work in progress, and that's a bit about what I want to talk to you about this evening. I mean, it really is a work in progress, and it's a very exciting direction. And it's because when we think about matter, particularly matter at the atomic scale and the scale of individual electrons, the world of quantum physics becomes very important, and it's quantum mechanics and quantum science that dictates our behavior and our interactions. It's very different than our world today. And it's because the length scales are so different that we don't see it today. We're used to human length scales on the order of feet and inches. We think about our blood cells down to the fraction of a human hair diameter, down to chromosomes. Then you get to molecules and DNA, which themselves are composed of individual atoms and electrons. And for quantum technology to really make things work, we need to understand the behavior of individual atoms and electrons quantum mechanically and see if we can build a technology based on that. And that technology will be very, very different than what we have right now. So to put this in perspective, today's technology, of course, uses atoms, and we actually take them and we assemble them with remarkable precision. We build beautiful lattices of materials, beautiful single crystals, and we're really, really good at fabricating devices that all of us benefit with today. And to give you a sense of that, if you look at the upper left-hand corner of the screen, that's a single crystal of silicon. It's taller than I am, a couple of feet in diameter, and they're just beautiful materials. We've gotten incredibly good at this, and they're sliced into wafers, which you see in the upper right. And then devices are fabricated from them in clean rooms that you saw in the video in the lower left, and they're used in our technology very well. But for quantum technology, we're taking a very different approach. We're going to take a step back, and instead of trying to remove all the defects from materials that have been so important in today's technology, we're going to put them back in. We're going to take beautiful single crystals, and we're going to make them defective. And the reason that they're defective is that these defects are missing parts of an atom, or of a crystal, excuse me, are ways that we can hold individual electrons and play with their quantum states. Oddly enough, these are experiments that could have been done decades ago and people simply didn't look. So it's the defects that are very important. And those of you who have bought diamond, for example, are very familiar with defects. Different colors of diamond are because there are different defects in there. And in fact, diamond is a semiconductor like silicon, and you can build quantum systems out of diamond as much as anything. So the theme of the next 10 minutes or so is the fact that defects are good, and semiconductors, in a sense, are like people. It's the defects that make them very interesting. I don't know how that got there. So we're going to take a beautiful single crystal, and we're going to riddle it with defects. And the picture that you see in the upper right is a semiconductor that we've actually taken a very pure material, filled it with defects, and light is glowing from these individual spots, each one or just two electrons that we can control, and control their quantum mechanical properties. And it's these types of quantum properties that are going to serve the basis of a future technology. So, what are these properties? Matt mentioned in his introduction the idea of spin. And electrons have a charge that we're familiar with today. It's how our electrical circuits work. But each electron also has a quantum property called its spin that we typically don't take advantage of today. And the spin of an electron is just what you might think. The electron spins around this axis, just like the Earth spins around its axis. Or a top spinning on the table, which can also precess. The electron has this property as well. But in a classical system, like the Earth spinning or a particle spinning, the spin can be in one of two states, right? It can spin clockwise or anti-clockwise. Or like a little bar magnet, it can be up or down. In the quantum world, the spin can be in all different combinations at the same time, an infinite number of possibilities, and you don't actually know which one it's in. It's a very, very different way of looking at nature. So what do I mean? I mean, classically, if you take a single particle, say a little refrigerator magnet, we're pretty comfortable with the fact, right, that it can point up or it can point down. In the quantum world, this little spin is pointing in all different combinations, all at the same time, and we don't really know what to do with it until we look at it. And the moment we look at it, we know what position it's in. And every time we look at it, it can be in a different position. So you might think that's actually pretty annoying. It can be. But it's actually the basis of a very exciting technology. And so this is an example of some data that students take in the IME, just down the street from us, where they're looking at a single electron, looking at it in this quantum superposition of states, on the desktop, at room temperature, and that red curve shows this electron spin pointing up and down and everything in between. It's very, very sensitive to its environment. And again, you might think that's a problem for a technology. You don't want things to be very sensitive, right? You walk around with them, you want them to be very stable. But in the quantum world, that's actually a real opportunity. And let me explain what I mean. It means that if you have one of these quantum states, you have a remarkable sensor. It's a sensor with extraordinary precision. And if you bring it next to a very small object, like a molecule, you have the opportunity to move this around and get the exact structure of the molecule, something that's very, very difficult to do today. And to put that in perspective, some of you may have seen magnetic resonance imaging systems in hospitals, where at the human scale, they work by taking very large magnets, orienting the spins in your body, and then watching them relax. And because different spins relax at different rates based on their environment, you get an image. And the image you see like this is at the human scale. Now imagine you could do images like this at the molecular scale. Things would be very, very different. And here's an example of how much this has changed in just the last 2 to 3 years, going from dozens of orders of magnitude of resolution down to a handful, by taking these quantum states, bringing them very close to molecules, and determining the structure and functional relationships of these molecules with a quantum probe. And you can see why that will be very, very important in everything from drug design to new materials discovery. And we'll talk about that just for a few minutes in just a second. Students here in the Department of Chemistry, as well as in the IME, have come up with some clever ideas of taking these quantum probes, putting them in very small pieces of material, and putting them in living cells. And what you can see on the left is an example of a quantum state in a human endothelial cell that's alive. And this quantum state acts as a type of beacon, looking at the electric, the magnetic, and the thermal fields in a living cell and sending the information out to the observer. And in principle, should also be able to watch information moving in and out of a single cell. And the reason I thought these were interesting examples to show is it would be very difficult, if not impossible, to do this today with classical technologies. Now, there's a second quantum aspect of physics that's pretty interesting, and this is sort of the California version of it. Matt mentioned some of us were from Southern California. Two bodies, one soul. And what that means is you can build a type of state, a piece of information, and put it into a pair, two or three electrons. And you can put it in such a way that this information is entangled. You can't read it from one particle or the other. It has to be the pair. It's literally put into both of them. And this has a very peculiar property. Once information is put into the pair, you can separate this pair. And you can separate over very large distances, over a city, over a state, over a country, and between planets even. It doesn't actually matter. Even though they're separated and there's no physical connection, they're connected. People found this very, very hard to believe in the early days of quantum physics, that even though there's no physical connection, you measure one, it affects the other. I see you don't believe this. That's reasonable. Einstein didn't believe it either. And in fact, when this first came to being, you know, he had a very famous phrase, Spukhafte Wärmekung. I'm sure you've heard of that. But you probably heard of the translation, spooky action at a distance. That was literally the translation at the time. People found it very hard to grasp this. It made no sense. How can you communicate when there's no physical connection. A student from our group moved on to become a faculty member at Netherlands and Delft University of Technology, and very recently did that experiment. He put information into a pair of electrons, moved them over a kilometer apart in Delft, and did the measurement. He measured one, which in fact affected the other. This was reported a few months ago in the New York Times. Spooky action is real. It's remarkable. It's something we don't see in our world at our length scales, but is common at the scale of individual particles. Interaction without a physical connection. I see you still don't believe this. Okay. So how could you take this type of science and move it into a technology? And one thing you could do is take a commercial material, and Paul will talk about some of this in a few minutes, materials like silicon-based structures, fill it with defects, like I just talked about, and try and create states where the electrons trapped in these defects are entangled with nearby nuclei of atoms that also have spins, make entangled pairs. So students here have done this very recently, just a few months ago, and they built thousands of these entangled spins in commercial wafers of semiconductors, something that people really never thought you could easily do, but it turns out people just didn't try. And the reason this is very exciting is that each of these entangled pairs acts as a type of quantum device. And all of these quantum devices serve as a framework for a future quantum machine. And it's a quantum machine that would enable you to do models of quantum systems that even with infinite computing power that's available today, it's just not possible to model systems like this. You cannot model quantum systems with classical machines. So these are called quantum simulators, and people all over the world are working on this. And the reason is a very exciting one. If you can understand matter at very basic levels, you should be able to bring phenomena that we've seen today into the ambient world. For example, room temperature superconductors. Superconductors are materials that carry electricity with no resistance. These exist at lower temperatures. If you could bring that to room temperature, we would be in a very different world. You would be able to convey electricity with no resistance and distribute power. You would have levitating trains and levitating transportation because you could generate magnetic fields that oppose each other at room temperature. It'd be a very exciting discovery, and in principle, it might well be possible if we could understand materials at a fundamental level. And perhaps more importantly, it would give us options into pharmaceutical design, being able to design drugs whose targets could be well decided and testing done through complete simulation. It would obviate the need to do a lot of tests. You could calculate every possible functional interaction from a drug with a quantum simulator. And this is the type of future technology that a lot of us think about today. So some of you are wondering probably, where is your transporter? It's a reasonable question. Well, quantum information and this idea of entanglement offers a pathway to move information called teleportation. And teleportation is a pretty interesting phenomenon. If you look at these two purple atoms, as I just showed you, you can build them in a way that they're entangled even kilometers apart or planets apart. What's also true in principle is you bring a third object into this entangled pair, the entanglement acts like a type of superhighway and will transmit the information instantly to the next particle. It will make a complete copy instantaneously, even though there's no physical connection. You don't believe that either. That's reasonable. But just again, a couple of months ago at NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology in Washington, that's been demonstrated teleportation over 60 miles. They teleported the particle essentially between the University of Chicago and the University of Notre Dame. Yeah, no, it's amazing. And it worked. So now you're asking again, where's my transporter? There are a few experimental problems here. First of all, it doesn't work most of the time. So it only works once every 10 minutes. So we just talked about the number of atoms in a person, right? It's a large number. So to actually move a person from one place to the other, assuming you could do it, you'd literally die trying. I mean, with these estimates, it would be 10 trillion ages of the universe. The universe ages about 10 billion years, so that's a very long time. So it's the sort of thing you would not want to try at home. But it's a very exciting time for us. I mean, what's becoming very clear for a lot of us, both in the IME and around the world work in these fields, is that we're building technologies now that are approaching single atoms. And when you build a technology with single atoms, the laws of quantum science determine the behavior, not our classical world. So quantum engineering is very much becoming a reality. We believe that will enable new designs and discoveries of materials, both for practical applications and pharmaceuticals, for medical applications. And because of the unusual nature of these quantum states, it also provides nearly tamper-proof security for quantum communication, something that's already being driven by startup companies right now around the world. So we believe there are a lot of fundamental physical and biological systems that we can probe and learn more about with quantum sensing. And when you put this in perspective, when the field of semiconductor science was just starting, people never thought that there would be personal computers, global communication. And yet, when we think about now quantum information processing, what's really exciting is we actually don't know what's ahead of us in the future. So thank you very much.